The next section of the anatomy review deals with the issues of cell biology and histology. And we're going to start out by looking at an individual cell with regard to its subcellular organelles and its cytoskeleton, and finish up this chapter with a comparison of various different forms of epithelia. Now, there are a couple of issues with regard to the anatomy review of histology. First off, histology is an all-encompassing subject, aside from the fact that we're going to spend some time dealing with normal tissue identification. To review a functional histology implies that we have to talk about biochemistry, physiology, pathology, pharmacology, and so on and so forth, which obviously we're not going to get into. So we really want to concentrate on normal tissue identification. Why does a tissue look like it does? And when we deal with a tissue, recognize that there are four fundamental tissues that are going to make up virtually every organ in the body. Every organ basically has epithelial tissue, connective tissue, muscular tissue, muscle, and nervous tissue. So our job as we go through this is to identify those tissue components, deal with what cell types might be present, what their functional significance is, and particularly when we get to epithelia, exam questions frequently deal with where are the stem cells in a tissue or an organ or an epithelium, and what are they actually stem cells for? All right, the other issue we're going to deal with when we get into cell biology, which is first, and that is, what are the different functions and the appearance of organelles? And histologically, we can kind of subdivide organelles into either membrane-bound organelles, which will be the largest of the subcellular structures, versus non-membrane-bound organelles. And non-membrane-bound organelles make up the cytoskeleton. So we're going to distinguish those not only anatomically functionally, but what we want to concentrate on is what cellular components, membrane or non-membrane bound, look like in the electron microscope, which is frequently how they're viewed. All right, so the first organelle we're going to deal with is the largest of the membrane-bound organelles, and this is the nucleus. Certainly, as you know from biochemistry, it's the site of DNA replication and transcription of DNA into RNA molecular precursors. Contains all the enzymes required for repair and replication of newly synthesized DNA and its transcription. Nucleus is one of two organelles that's actually bound by a double membrane in the form of the nuclear envelope. And inside the nuclear envelope will be the nuclear lamina, a nucleolus, basically what we call a nuclear inclusion, and obviously two different forms of chromatin. The nucleus itself in the electron microscope, like everything in the electron microscope, is either black or white. So when structures are described in the electron microscope, it's kind of as if you were interpreting a radiograph. Things are considered in the electron microscope to be either electron dense, which means they're black, or electron lucent, which means they're light or unstained. And this story kind of begins with a picture of a nucleus. That happens to be from a liver hepatocyte, although it could be from virtually any protein-producing cell. And you'll note first off that in the EM, the dominant feature of a nucleus is its chromatin content. And certainly in a typical active protein-producing cell, euchromatin is going to be much more prevalent than heterochromatin, because euchromatin is the active form of chromatin, and it constitutes in a typical protein-producing cell about 90% of the available chromatin, whereas heterochromatin, the more electron-dense form of chromatin, black, shown in this micrograph, is the inactive form. And this is also a very good electron micrograph of a nucleolus, as we well know, a site of ribosomal RNA synthesis and ribosomal assembly. The nuclear envelope, as we said earlier, is a structure that is in the form of a double membrane. And it contains pores that we'll see are continuous with the endoplasmic reticulum. And there's only one other subcellular organelle that contains a double membrane surrounding it, and that will be a mitochondria. Chromatin, as we indicated, it's either in the form of heterochromatin, which is transcriptionally inactive, constituting about 10% of the chromatin in a typical eukaryotic cell, or it's euchromatin, which is basically a more extended and active form, which accounts in a typical protein-producing cell for about 90% of the total chromatin. Next, the nucleolus. We alluded to this earlier in the electron micrograph. It's responsible for ribosomal RNA synthesis and ribosomal assembly. There are a couple of morphologically distinct zones which can be identified in an electron micrograph. The active zones are the granular zone and the fibrillar zone, one of them found at the periphery, one more centrally located. But the fibrillar center, the actual central portion of the nucleolus, is the part which is inactive in that it contains DNA that's not being actively transcribed.